privacy at the VA. This is the subcommittee's third privacy hearing. We take this subject very seriously. Veterans entrust the VA with data on every aspect of their lives, often more information than any other government agency or company possesses. Yet, the VA struggles at every level to comply with the law and keep veterans' health, personal, and financial information secure. Data breaches happen every few months, and they have taken many different forms. We have seen mass errors by a contractor mailing letters to the wrong veterans. We have seen employees lose or steal records and send files beyond the VA network where their ultimate destination is unknown. We have also seen companies gain access to veterans' data under false pretenses. No successful large-scale cyber attack on the VA has been disclosed in several years. But we also know the department is the target of thousands of attacks every day. It remains a constant risk. The VA can be the target and at fault, sometimes both in the very same data breach. No organization can prevent every breach. But in many of these incidents, VA officials did not realize that the veterans' information had been mishandled until well after the fact. In these situations, time is critical. The only way to step in before veterans' data makes its way from unwitting recipients to criminals is to move fast. Employees reported most of the breaches we will discuss today, and I commend them for that. The examples I just described are a significant problem and put veterans in a precarious position. But they represent the Stone Age compared to the privacy risk posed by artificial intelligence. Much has been said about AI here on Capitol Hill. Unfortunately, I think most of it can be characterized as utopian or apocalyptic. The AI companies and their emissaries want us to focus on speculative, civilizational threats rather than the practical problems that are right before us. AI has been with us for several years in different forms, but is quickly becoming ubiquitous. The VA is accustomed to operating as an island. That has many downsides, but in research and technology, it can actually be beneficial for protecting the private information. But the AI business model is moving quickly and overtaking the island. AI is being embedded into all sorts of software. Dual-use AI models are proliferating, and narrow AI applications are broadening. In other words, the days of putting one data set into an AI model that only does one thing are ending. And the VA has thousands of contractors and partner companies that access veterans' health and personal data today. Controlling how they apply AI will be extremely difficult. Without a doubt, I think the VA is using AI for some admirable purposes. Applying machine learning to analyze medical images can save lives by recognizing indicators of illnesses that the most experienced doctors may miss. Chatbots for customer service can be helpful if done well, and the VA has a lot of catching up to do. Sophisticated automation can clean up the VA's troves of disorganized administrative data in hours, whereas employees have been struggling with it for years. On the other hand, using AI to predict clinical outcomes or mental health problems may be powerful, but it presents a host of ethical problems. Even if the VA manages to prevent this bias, the imposition on civil liberties cannot be ignored. My goal here is to learn more about the VA is already doing with AI and how our witnesses plan to adapt the department's old-fashioned process as the technology evolves around them. I appreciate our witnesses being here to explain all that. With that, I yield to Ranking Member Sherfalus McCormick for her opening statement.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you to our witnesses for being here today. Our hearing this afternoon touches on topics that are both old and new to our subcommittee: data privacy in the integration of artificial intelligence, or AI, at VA. In an ever-growing and ever-connected digital world, our attention in matters of data privacy and budding technology is more important than ever. While this interconnectedness has brought us closer to our friends, colleagues, and even strangers, It has also raised numerous concerns about the privacy of user data, especially in healthcare. In the past 10 to 15 years, nearly 6,000 healthcare breaches of 500 or more records have been reported to HHS's Office of Civil Rights. Several of these reports originated out of the VA itself. It has been almost 2 years since our last hearing on data privacy. In that time, VA has reported at least 7 data breaches affecting over 4,000 veterans across the country. While this committee has heard repeatedly from VA about their IT infrastructure as well as their privacy and security programs, I look forward to hearing about VA's current and future efforts to protect veterans' data as a result of these breaches. We also plan to discuss VA's rapidly expanding use of artificial intelligence. While AI has been around for many years, it has recently become a hot topic in the media. I'm interested in hearing from VA how they intend to utilize these tools while protecting veterans' private health information and personally identifiable information. In 2019, VA stood up the VA National Artificial Intelligence Institute and the AI network, bringing experts, clinicians, and researchers together to collaborate on innovative AI proposals that seek to reduce administrative burdens, improving staff experience, and provide better patient outcomes. In October of 2023, the Biden administration released an executive order on the safe, secure, and trustworthy development and use of artificial intelligence, which provides a government-wide framework to establish responsible AI development and application across federal agencies and offices. This EO builds off previous Trump administration guidance encouraging federal agencies to promote confidence and trust in AI in their respective jurisdictions while still maintaining integrity in patient and user safety. In a briefing provided to committee staff, VA acknowledged that they are still early in their development and adoption of AI and have committed to a cautious delivery of these tools. As this committee knows, the rollout of any enterprise-wide technology or even a new tool, just one VA MC, requires much planning and collaboration amongst leadership, staff, and patients alike. For a successful integration of AI into healthcare visits, claims, processing, and IT infrastructures, VA must remain committed to gradual and intentional growth of these systems. Similarly, this committee must remain committed to providing consistent and clear oversight to ensure better outcomes than what we have seen in other IT modernization efforts. Our VA employees, veterans, and their families deserve this much. However, in shying away from technological advancements in the name of protecting our veterans, we only end up creating a VA that is less responsive, outdated, and at times less transparent. VA has a place to define itself as both a leading healthcare provider and a large federal employer. In how it adopts emerging technology, integrating these advances when they are beneficial for both patients and providers is not something we should shy away from, but rather something we should welcome, albeit cautiously. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I yield back.
Thank you, Ranking Member Sherfless McCormick. Before we proceed, I ask unanimous consent that any members of the Health Subcommittee be permitted to participate in this hearing without objection. So ordered. Dr. Miller-Meeks, would you like to make any opening remarks?
Thank you for recognizing me, Chair. Good afternoon. I want to thank Chairman Rosendale and Ranking Member Sherfless McCormick for having me here today. I chair the Health Subcommittee for the VA. I also am a physician and a veteran. As the utilization of AI in healthcare becomes more common, it is important that we recognize the risks and challenges that come with it. AI has immense potential to transform the way VA delivers healthcare, including access. This committee will ensure that the VA does so with caution and an understanding of the risk. The burden of safeguarding that information is enormous. It also requires infallibility. This standard would be difficult to meet in a closed system, but VHA, like other healthcare systems, requires outside partners to execute its mission. Like other health systems, the VA has seen data breaches that occur with alarming frequency. An example is the breach in VISNs 1, 2, 4, and 5 at the end of last year that affected nearly 50,000 veterans. Some breaches are the result of internal mistakes, and some are the work of malicious actors. In some cases, seemingly innocuous internal errors are taken advantage of by external actors, such as the publication of source code on GitHub in 2022, which was cloned by 6 foreign IP addresses. This committee will take responsibility seriously as we explore VA's use of AI and its adaptation to ensure the security of veterans' data. I appreciate our witnesses' willingness to do so, and I yield to Chairman Rosendale.
Thank you very much, Representative Miller-Meeks. I will now introduce the witnesses on our first and only panel. From the VA, we have Chief Technology Officer Charles Worthington. Mr. Worthington, serves as the Chief AI Officer. It's good to see you again. We also have Dr. Gil Alterovitz, the Director of VA's National Artificial Intelligence Institute. In addition, we have Deputy Chief Information John Oswalt, who serves as the Chief Privacy Officer, and Ms. Stefania Griffin, the Director of Information Access and Privacy Office in the Veterans Health Administration. Finally, we have Ms. Shane Tews, a non-resident senior fellow at the American Enterprise Institute. I ask the witnesses to please stand and raise your right hands. Do you solemnly swear under penalty of perjury that the testimony you are about to provide is the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth? Thank you, and let the record reflect that all the witnesses have answered in the affirmative. Mr. Worthington, you are now recognized for 5 minutes to deliver your opening statement on behalf of the VA.
Good afternoon, Chairman Rosendale, Ranking Member Sherfalus McCormick, and distinguished members of the subcommittee. Thank you for the opportunity to testify today about the Department of Veterans Affairs' efforts in patient data and privacy and artificial intelligence. My name is Charles Worthington, and I'm the Chief Technology Officer and the agency's Chief Artificial Intelligence Officer in VA's Office of Information and Technology. And I'm accompanied today by Mr. John Oswalt, the Deputy Chief Information Officer, Freedom of Information Act and Records and Assessment Compliance Office, NOIT, Dr. Gil Alterovitz, the Director of the National AI Institute and VHA's Chief AI Officer, and Ms. Stephanie Griffin, Director of Information Access and Privacy Office within VHA. VA is committed to protecting veterans' data privacy while responsibly harnessing the promise of artificial intelligence to better serve veterans. While AI can be a powerful tool, we must adopt it with proper controls, oversight, and security. The department's taking a measured approach as we begin to scale AI solutions to ensure that we're adopting these powerful tools safely. As the largest healthcare and benefits provider in the nation and an early adopter of an electronic health record many decades ago, VA has a complex technical ecosystem, including one of the world's largest health record repositories. While we're enthusiastic about the vast potential of AI, VA is equally concerned about privacy, ethical use, and effectiveness of AI. Governance plays a key role in how VA has approached AI development, given the technology's unique risks and challenges. We will continue to invest in governance to ensure our use of AI comports with VA's security and privacy policies and within the trustworthy AI framework that our National AI Institute launched under the leadership of Dr. Alterovitz last year. Regarding privacy, securing veteran data is a top priority, as my colleagues John Oswalt and Stephanie Griffin can attest to. VA uses the National Institute of Standards and Technology Risk Management Framework to comprehensively manage and report on privacy and security risks. This NIST framework requires independent privacy and security reviews that prevent conflicts of interest in privacy and security assessments and audits. Furthermore, VA security controls reduce the risk and impact of potential incidents by deploying a diverse set of technologies within the department's environment. Of course, we must consider how our data security and privacy solutions interact with our users, veterans, and vendors to ensure that we're taking a balanced risk management approach that provides guardrails while also enabling exploration of emerging technologies, such as those AI solutions being pioneered by Dr. Alterovitz and his colleagues in VHA. VA has long been a leader in healthcare research and innovation, and we seek to continue that leadership position. In conclusion, I believe that AI represents a generational shift in how our computer systems will work and what they will be capable of. If used well, AI has the potential to empower our employees to provide better healthcare, faster benefits decisions, and more secure systems. Similar to other major transitions such as cloud computing or the rise of smartphones, VA will need to invest in and adapt our technical portfolio to take advantage of this shift. With the strategies, policies, and programs currently in place, the department will continue in its mission to protect the security and privacy of the data entrusted to us by the veterans we serve. Mr. Chairman, ranking members and members of the subcommittee, thank you for the opportunity to testify before the subcommittee today to discuss this important topic. My colleagues and I are happy to respond to any questions you might have.
Thank you, Mr. Worthington. The written statement of Mr. Worthington will be entered into the hearing record. Ms. Sues, you are now recognized for 5 minutes to deliver your opening statement.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I have to admit, when the staff called, I don't have any background in the Veterans Affairs area. I've been doing privacy for over 20 years, and so I've learned a lot over the last week, and I've been very impressed with the work that the agency already has been done in this area. So quickly, I'll just highlight some things that are in my written testimony. All the offers of immense improvement for veterans' well-being really can be enhanced with AI tools. But the most important part is instilling trust in the system. As you mentioned early on, the challenges we have of people possibly being taken advantage of. And then early on in your opening statement, quite a few of the things you said had human intervention elements to them. And now we add the speed of AI to it. We need to make sure that we sandbox these things so they are safe. So we need to be concerned about privacy, security, fairness, accountability from the start. And in developing responsibility, we can enable to provide to make faster and better informed decisions for our veterans and allow them to focus more on patients with AI tools. So in my written testimony, I do go more in depth about potential advancements for diagnostic treatments, predictive health care for preventive measures and early intervention, virtual health care assistance for VA health care desks and telemedicine enhancements, data integration and enhanced health care providers with AI tools, mental health support, and many more advancements we'll see with AI. To realize this future, we need to be dedicated to the cross-functional VA teams that evaluate every AI tool using metrics for security and addressing bias before approval. We must institute the same privacy rules as HIPAA, limit reliance on personal data, and develop AI research and training and retain the VA's governance to build confidence. Annual audits will be a further accountability item you need to incorporate. The payoff of adopting AI tools across diagnostics, predictive health care, telemedicine, mental health support, and more are too great to not purposely use AI thoughtfully. In closing, I urge earnest focus on ethics, inclusivity, and communications to unlock AI's potential while earning veterans' trust. I look forward to your questions, and I look forward to hearing from the panel.
Thank you very much, Ms. Tews. The written statement of Ms. Tews will be entered into the hearing record. And now we will proceed to questioning, and I recognize myself for 5 minutes. Mr. Worthington, the VA has a National AI Center, a working group, oversight committees, and an institutional review board for AI. Many of these seem like talking shops. Who vets proposed AI projects and decides what gets approved, what is inappropriate, and how veterans' data will be used?
Thank you for the question. The agency, I would say, is in our early stages of standing up the governance of AI as a separate category. And the framework that we've put in place with the National AI Institute, which Dr. Altervitz can talk more about, was basically designed to catalog use cases of AI across the agency and then assess those use cases for consistency with our trustworthy AI principles in relation to the earlier executive order on AI. And so at this moment, what we are attempting to do is document all of the cases that the VA is experimenting with and indeed bringing AI use cases into production and ensuring we have those documented so that we can assess them using the governance standards that will continue to evolve.
So who is ultimately, taking this information and making the final determination about what it will be used for and what it won't be used for? Is it a panel? Is it a group? Who's making the final call?
So in the new executive order guidance we've been provided by OMB, we are asked to stand up an AI governance committee that will be chaired by myself and the agency deputy secretary, and we're in the process of finalizing that. That is a requirement that's gonna come from OMB to the VA. In the past, what we've been using is our Data Governance Council framework, where AI use cases come to that council, which is able to look at the work of the National AI Institute staff and assess them.
Go ahead.
Thanks. So I just want to add in, there's kind of multiple layers, right? At the local level with the medical centers, we've been piloting an AI oversight committee. And we've been doing that first through the NIH centers to see how that could scale. There's other work going on to look then at the VISN level, And then finally, I think as was mentioned, the AI work group is at the central VA level, part of the data governance council, the agency governance body. And in this new executive order, there's a statement basically about elevating that up so that there are higher level people on that committee, but still, you know, tying it down to the central office. And so doing that, you're able to triage different risk profiles and be able to scale these different types of analyses.
So that gives me another question, though. So, Mr. Worthington, if we have these decisions being made at the local level, we have them being made at the VISN level, and then we have them being made at your level, has anyone ever rejected an AI use case?
I would have to go back.
And how do we make sure that we've got some type of conformity or some, you know, consistency right amongst?
I think that consistency is exactly what we want to create at the central level so that we can cascade that out to the field so that decisions can be made locally for smaller pilots or for earlier stage risks. It is important, I think, to point out, though, that anything that is going live into production and touching veteran data, that would follow the same processes as existing IT systems have to follow in terms of an authority to operate, an authority to connect. And so if we're talking about bringing a system into production, whether it involves AI or not, there's a sort of an existing technology assessment process that we would use to approve the use of those.
Okay. Mr. Alterovitz, there are now three executive orders setting out guiding principles for AI. It's up to you and your colleagues to interpret and apply them. You've created some new offices. You haven't yet updated most of your policies for AI. Let me ask you a simple question. How do you know a bad AI use case when you see one?
So we've been working together on integrating all of the different policies into our trustworthy AI framework that came out this July. It integrates those executive orders as well as NIST, as well as agency-specific guidance. Like we have a data ethics framework, for example. And so it actually became the first department-wide trustworthy AI framework that includes all those latest items. And so using that and using the implementation guide that we've been now developing, there are a series of questions that we analyze to determine if a use case falls under the consistent or inconsistent category with the principles, and thereby being consistent or inconsistent with the different guidances like EO 13960, 14110, and the other ones. And so that is our process, and we've done it now about a couple of years, and we're going to upgrade it now with the new executive order that came out.
Thank you. I'll now recognize Representative Sherfless McCormick for 5 minutes questioning.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. VA hosts the largest integrated healthcare system in the country, making its responsibility for a wide swath of data, most of which must remain secure and protected. How is VA working to bring groundbreaking technology to benefit veterans while also balancing potential privacy?
Thank you for the question, and it's a good question because obviously we're hearing a lot about artificial intelligence, but in some ways, the problem of deciding which technologies we can use at the VA that ensure veteran data and privacy are intact, that problem is not new, and VA, especially our OIT office, has a lot of existing policies in place to ensure that any new system that we bring onto the network or entrust veteran data inside complies with VA's existing data privacy and data security policies. And so we would expect to apply many of those same policies in most of the same ways, whether or not that system uses AI or is a more traditional computing system.
This question's for Ms. Griffin. Ms. Griffin, over the past 2 years, VA has been a subject to several data breaches, jeopardizing the PII and the PHI of thousands of veterans. What safeguards does the VA currently have in place to help protect against future breaches?
Thank you. There are numerous mechanisms and processes that VHA has in place to safeguard veterans' PII and PHI along the lines of not only policies and procedures, but training of our staff. We also have compliance monitoring and audits that are performed, as well as many other processes that we put in place to comply with various federal privacy laws and regulations, including the HIPAA privacy rule requirements. I'd be happy to provide greater detail if you would like for the record.
That'd be wonderful. And could the adoption of this new AI infrastructure exacerbate any existing privacy issues at VA? How might AI assist in protecting against future breaches?
So the federal privacy laws and regulations, including the HIPAA privacy rule, they are technology neutral. So they put the same processes and mechanisms in place to protect and safeguard data regardless of the technology. However, certainly, as you look to new technologies, we look to the privacy impact analyses that we have to perform and may put additional security and information security processes in place and enhancements around that technology to ensure privacy.
My next question is really about the biases in AI. For Mr. Worthington, as we continue to support improving and expanding access to care among minority veteran populations, we must be mindful of the biases that accompany the application of AI. How is the VA working to combat these biases that may impact access to care for minority veterans?
It's a wonderful question, and it's one that our colleagues in VHA who designed the Trustworthy AI framework have really been thinking a lot about, as have both administrations with the executive orders. I think the key to understanding how any particular AI may introduce biases is to understand the data that it was trained on and then the outputs that it gives given a set of inputs. And so assessing the potential for bias in each of the models is one of the six principles of our ethical or our trustworthy AI framework, and it's one of those things the governance bodies are looking at when they're assessing each of the use cases.
The VA has historically struggled when it comes to collecting data on veterans' racial, ethnic, and LGBT plus identities. How is the VA compensating for gaps in its data to ensure that bias is mitigated in AI projects?
That is a great question. I may have to take part of that back for the record, but I think that, obviously the VA's health system is very large and our data is, we have lots of data, but the veteran population also is not, exactly representative of the country in terms of gender and other attributes. And so every time we create a model or any sort of analysis using only VA data, the researchers have to be cognizant of the limitations inherent in that data set.
And Ms. Tews, what problems or risks do you expect to see if VA isn't able to successfully account for biases in its AI products?
Well, first of all, I want to reiterate the importance of transparency and accountability throughout the entire process so you always know what is being looked at and how it's being reviewed. And part of that is then making sure that in the areas where you're concerned about wanting to find results without knowing who it is that you disaggregate the data. So you don't have certain data sets that are compiled into that. And that will help just alleviate, sometimes we just share too much, candidly. So we have that problem not only in the VA, but just in general use of data, is we just tend to grab everything that we can. So when you're doing information flow, you make sure that you're only using the pieces that need to be participated in that and disaggregating the pieces that don't need to be there. That doesn't mean that you can't make sure that you're looking for things around bias. And besides bias on minorities, you realize that women have had this challenge all along in healthcare as well. I mean, there's during COVID, I had a friend of mine who said, look, why would I want to give my mother a shot that was designed for a 180-pound man? And I hadn't really thought about that. I don't have a problem with a shot. But I was like, oh, see your point. And we've done a lot of that throughout our history. So I think while we're reviewing all of this, we have an opportunity to do a lot of corrections in the way that we have been doing healthcare in general for a long time. So I think this is a good opportunity.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I yield back.
Thank you, Ranking Member Sherfless McCormick. I now recognize my good friend from Texas, Representative Self.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Once again, and this is my common comment, we're talking about inputs. So I want to try to get at outputs. Dr. Alterovitz, how many projects or use cases do you currently have underway?
Clarification, is that a question of for our group specifically, for the VA in general, or?
Your National Institute.
The National Institute. We collaborate and engage in, I would say, maybe 15 to 20 projects.
15 to 20. How many are in widespread use as opposed to test?
So of the ones, so we typically start with the early stage. Mm-hmm. And so the goal is that eventually they may end up to be, widely used. We started a few years ago, and through various mechanisms such as AI text prints, we've had a few of them launched to become pilots that are used in up to four or so medical centers, and then the next stage beyond that is scaling up.
So how many are in widespread use?
If you define widespread as across the nine network, then...
I'll let you define it.
Yeah, if you define it as across the nine network, then I would say maybe like three.
Three. And when do we expect to see significant outputs from these uses?
Significant outputs. Can you clarify?
Improvement in veterans' health care.
Got it. So in terms of...
That's always the bottom line here. We talk a lot about theory in this committee. We talk a lot about processes. We talk a lot about inputs. I'm more interested in the output and the health benefits to the veteran.
Great, great. Because some of them also involve efficiency and cost savings. So all of those are designed to do that, actually, the three that I was thinking about. And I should say just that, you know, the ones that we're looking at are just one piece of how we look at AI solutions, right? We have different mechanisms, like I said, AI tech sprints.
So when do you expect to see an output?
Well, with an AI tech sprint, you see an output within 90 days if it is something usable that you want to then go on to contracting.
And these three are giving you significant outputs today?
Yes. Right. Correct.
And I might just add that in addition to the projects that Dr. Alterovitz is describing, where his group worked specifically to shepherd them along, there are other uses of AI in production today across our health system. Primarily, these are things in categories like medical devices. For example, there's a product called GI Genius, which helps oncologists or others identify scans and look for cancers. And so in addition to those that this organization helped with, the VA does have a number of the more traditional AI models in production now.
Okay, so I understand you've got about 1,100 petabytes of sensitive information and you're rolling this out. And a sentence in our packet here that got my attention is the commercial sector has eaten up all of the available data sets, and now they need non-public data sets. So how in the world are you going to protect 1,100 petabytes of sensitive information? Because there's the old saying, a secret is something you tell one person at a time. How are you going to protect against the cascading release across the commercial sector? And it seems to me like it is impossible to put the horse back in the barn once it's out. Can you talk to me about that?
It is a great question, and it's something we think about all the time, how to protect that data. We do have existing contractual rules around what vendors can do with the data. And so in general, when we're building models or analyzing this data, that is happening within the VA environment with tools that we're hosting internally, as opposed to sending that data outside of the VA.
Okay, so I'm about out of time. So what is the sanction if someone releases the data? What is the sanction you have on them?
I might defer to Mr. Oswald on that.
Well, it defers back to the contractual language. In the IT realm, there is standard language in every contract which lays out the expectations.
So give me an example of a sanction for someone that would release sensitive information.
Well, I know it's an acquisitions question, but I've seen contracts over my career that have been canceled because of non-performance to the letter of the contract. For egregious activity, it would probably be turned over to our Inspector General's office for investigation.
Has that happened with any of, yes, I know it has. Mr. Chairman, I yield back.
Thank you very much, Representative Self. I now recognize Representative Miller Meeks from Iowa.
Thank you very much, Chair Rosendale and Ranking Member Sherfless McCormick, and thank all our witnesses for being here. It seems as we go through this information that we think of AI, but AI in and of itself is not necessarily a source of release of private healthcare information or PII, that simply having electronic or digitization of data can lead to leaks. And often it seems the human link, having worked in the healthcare field for numerous years, may be the weakest link. So I think as we identify potential pitfalls, that we have to remember that we have to have the best cybersecurity and safety and access to care, and keep all of those in mind as we juggle through this. As a clinician, I understand the value AI can bring to the practice of medicine. It can help with everything from the diagnosis of disease to transcription of clinical notes to the development of a response back to a patient from repetitive machine learning and from creating staffing plans to coaching health behaviors. I can also see the potential as the PACT Act is unveiled, and as we're still determining toxic substances, that we can identify and prevent and form causation or causality from toxic substances, which we've only scratched the surface on. So this integration, I think, is really important, and we see the value, but we also understand that there are challenges ahead. Ms. Tooth, thank you for testifying before the committee today. In your written testimony, you state that the VA must be vigilant in creating proper safeguards around veteran data privacy and security. In your opinion, how can the VA implement AI and other algorithmic technologies to increase efficiency with both administrative items and the delivery of care without compromising patient safety and privacy?
So one thing to keep in mind is that you are dealing with a closed loop, which I think a lot of us, when we think about artificial intelligence right now, are really fascinated with the learning language models, the LLM, which is a lot of data going out from a lot of sources. You have a very finite, I mean, it's a lot of terabytes of data, but it's a finite area where you can actually do some amazing sandbox studies that you can't do in the open public. So I would think, I'm not a clinician, but the whole idea of what you could do in an environment like the Veterans Affairs on medicine is very amazing, as long as we make sure that those guardrails are in place, that we do have the terms of use, I call it policy through procurement. You know, we make sure that those are candidly fines. You know, you get outside your remit, you're going to see probably a major financial fine for doing that. It'll keep you inside the guardrail. And then knowing ahead of time what it is you're trying to discover, so you keep within the sandbox where you're looking to participate. So those are, they're not overly complicated. It's just you have to actually commit to them and make sure that the information doesn't go outside of where it's supposed to go, and you do with the information what you say you're going to do.
Mr. Worthington, does the VA use the LAION data set to train AI?
I am not familiar with that. Dr. Altrovitz, are you familiar with that one? We may have to take that back for the record.
We can certainly take that back for the record, but there isn't like one approach. There isn't a standardized approach to doing that at this time.
The reason for asking that question, a 2022 Ars Technica article found that the LAION data set contained pictures that originated from medical records, which made their way into the data set without authorization from patients who were the subjects. Now, as a clinician and a physician who has published, you have to get permission from patients to use their images in any publication that you would utilize. So how does the VA assure that PHI and PII, whether images or text, are not leaking into publicly available data sets, either by accident, omission, or purposefully, especially through contractors and their business associates who have access to data used to deliver or assist the VA in delivering healthcare?
Thank you for the question, Congresswoman. We have a I'd say robust existing privacy policy on all vendor and IT contracts that really is explicit about what our partners are allowed to do with VA data and not allowed. And so any time we are allowing a vendor access to VA data, it's usually just under the strict confines of what that contract is for. And my colleagues could talk more about the specifics, but we would be seeking to avoid cases where veteran data, or really any of our data, would wind up in some general purpose model that it was not expected to be.
Well, certainly if an employee can be terminated in a healthcare system for talking about a patient in an elevator, I would think that sanctions, loss of contract, and especially financial sanctions would be appropriate. Mr. Chair, I'd like to enter into the record the Ars Technica article I mentioned from 9/22/21.
Without objection.
Thank you, and I yield.
Thank you, Representative Miller Meeks. Mr. Altrovitz and Ms. Griffin, on this same topic about the patients themselves, what's going on with their information, do you notify and or do you believe
that you have a responsibility to notify veterans or any American when their health or personal information is fed into an AI model, and whether the analysis that affects them was done by AI rather than a person.
Yes, thank you for that. As I indicated earlier, the federal privacy laws and regulations that we adhere to, including the HIPAA privacy rule, is not technology specific. It's technology neutral. It's regarding the use of personally identifiable information and protected health information for purposes such as treatment, payment, healthcare operations. And so it's not focused on giving notice as it relates to specific technology. We are required to give notice to our veterans and our patients how we use their data, how we collect their data, how we share their data for the purposes. But again, it's not specific to a technology.
Okay, so my question is then, it sounds like they are not notified. It is not disclosed to the patient if their information is being analyzed by AI. Is that correct?
Correct. There is not a specific notice.
Do you think that is maybe something that should be in policy so that an individual knows that their information is being analyzed by AI and now is subject to all of the different potential problems that could take place that we haven't even identified yet, in addition to the fact that they may be getting some type of an analysis given to them that was created by AI?
I think that's something that the Data Governance Council and the AI framework that's being set up needs to look at more closely in terms of whether there is a specific use case notice that needs to be given. We often give informed consent in the healthcare setting for various processes and procedures, and it's possible that that's something that needs to be looked at more closely.
Yeah, I would highly recommend that if that disclosure is not going out and someone's information is going to be analyzed by AI, that certainly the patient should be made aware of that. It could present all types of issues going forward. And if the groups that are doing all of that analysis of what is and what is not acceptable, a disclosure at the very beginning would be a good place to start. Ms. Tews, how do you feel about this?
I think in general, it goes to my idea of transparency and accountability are important whenever you're using technology. You always want to regulate or put license on the outcome, not the technology. I mean, the idea is, what is it you're trying to accomplish? And don't worry about what the actual tech is, because it's going to change. But absolutely, I think that anytime somebody uses your healthcare information or you enter into something, you should know what's going on. It just is a human element. And I think we do that in our general healthcare system. We absolutely should be doing that in the veteran system. I would believe it probably is going on. I also am somebody, though, that I'm the first one to volunteer to be like, you want to throw that in a machine? Please do. So, the idea of having AI look at my results first and then an intern, I don't have a problem with that. I think that actually would probably perhaps get me earlier recognition on a few things, but I would want to be notified.
Thank you very much. Mr. Oswald, most of your data breaches happen when letters or digital files get sent to the wrong veterans or when paper records are misplaced. Typically, an employee or contractor makes a mistake and an employee discovers it. Once you realize a breach has happened, what do you do to trace down where the information went, and also what are you doing, what actions are you taking to get that information back again?
When a data breach happens, and it's either employee self-reported or a veteran might have received something that wasn't theirs, the privacy officer or the information security officer at the subject facility will enter an incident ticket in a system we call PSETS, which is the Privacy Security Event Tracking System. And there is a data breach response service team, a group of individuals who work for me, who begin the investigation of what happened. They work with the medical center folks, the staff, the veterans, a lot of times the individuals, and based on what they adjudicate, there is a VA-wide body called the Data Breach Core Team, which investigates further and makes the determination whether whether one is VA is at fault, and two is credit monitoring warranted, and also, you know, what type of event it is, PII or PHI.
Thank you. My time is up. We'll now recognize Representative Sherfless McCormick.
Thank you so much, Mr. Chairman. I wanted to examine some of the AI governance issues that we might potentially have. VA's move to the Cerner Millennium Electronic Health Record has highlighted concerns about the quality of VA's healthcare data. Specifically, the fact that the majority of the data does not conform to the standard data definition. How is VA accounting for this variation when developing new AI models?
It's a wonderful question. I don't think any of us up here are experts on the EHR program, but in general, I think that you are raising a very important challenge that we have when we're adopting AI, which is it's very rare that an AI product would live by itself. We need to figure out how to integrate these models and these insights into our existing software ecosystem, which, as you noted, is very complex. So I'm sure that that would require a lot of testing to make sure that it worked correctly with both the Cerner data models as well as the legacy Vista data models.
And would anybody know how this variation impacting the quality of the output, of the AI output?
I'm not familiar with that issue in particular.
I just wanted to add that one of the things that's most complicated when using AI in the healthcare setting is it's embedding in the workflow, right? So if someone has to enter another password or something like that, it takes them out of their workflow. It also, sometimes you lose data potentially as you have to kind of translate from one system to another. So essentially the closer it is into the native pipeline of data, the better you are going to be in terms of the output and how it will affect and be able to be stored and then used by future physicians for clinical decision making.
Thank you. My staff recently visited one of the automation sites for VBA's claims automation. While this seems to be beneficial to the automated decision support staff's perception of its usefulness was a little inconsistent. How is VA soliciting feedback from the frontline staff about ADS and other AI projects?
The ADS project in particular, I'm not personally familiar with, but I think that you're raising a great point around the importance of engaging with our workforce on the topic of AI. The way that AI, I think, could be most usefully applied in the VA and elsewhere is by augmenting the capabilities of our existing people. And so that means giving them new capabilities, but also training them how to use it and what it can and can't do, what its limitations are. And so I think we're going to have a lot of engagement with the workforce, not just AI experts, but really anyone that's using VA software, including this system, about what the system is intending to do, how it works, and getting to the point about transparency and explainability. I think being very communicative about what the system did and why is an important way to build that trust with our users.
And how is VA validating these models are working effectively?
Well, as a part of the governance framework, we are looking at basically what these models output compared to what should be expected. And so each time something is put into production, they are tested based on what is expected, you know, what should be given a set of inputs.
And I wanted to go back to the question before real quick. Is there a process in place where you're actually getting data and feedback from the frontliners presently?
With regards to that program in particular, I'm not familiar with it enough to let you know one way or the other. We could take the question back for the record. We do have a broader system, I know, that is designed to gather feedback from employees mm-hmm. on their experiences with various programs.
If not, I would like to see an implementation plan so we can have that information there. Because a lot of times we talk about getting feedback, but we never get around to actually getting that feedback. So if we have them able to articulate what their needs are and actually build it in, I think that would be the best case scenario for us. And how are they measuring how often the output does or does not meet the expectation?
Again, I'd have to take that one back for the record for that program.
Mr. Chairman, I yield back.
Thank you very much, Ranking Member Sherfless McCormick. I'm now recognized Representative Self.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I want to revisit both of my lines of questioning from the first question. First of all, for this hearing, you provided a list of 128 AI use cases. To the Senate, you provided a list of 300 AI use cases. and you've said there are 21 that have advanced to implementation. Why the difference in what you testified in the first round to these numbers in the second round?
Well, that's a great question. I think what you're seeing is that the use case inventory is a work in progress for us. And at different points in time, the inventory has been created to comply with various OMB memos. And so I'm not familiar with the specifics of the communication that you just mentioned about the inventory, but I think the inventory has been growing over time. And so at various points in time, it's...
The way I understand from the committee staff that these are numbers that you provided to us, the 128 and the 21, is that correct?
Dr. Alder Watson. Yeah, so I just wanted to clarify what these numbers could be in terms of...
Well, no, I don't want it speculation, Doctor. I appreciate it. My point is that we get this fairly often up here, who's in charge, who's on first. I just ask you to make sure who's in charge. I'm also not satisfied with your sanctions answers. A general contract acquisition answer is not satisfactory because of the importance, the potential devastating consequences of a breach of 1,100 petabytes of data, sensitive data. I think it's got to be, first, you've got to identify some sanctions, and they've got to be fairly severe sanctions, and they've got to be in policy up front. This is something you have got to settle in policy early. And frankly, in my mind, it is not going to be sufficient to say we're going to cancel a contract. Because as Dr. Miller Meeks pointed out, this is more serious than simply canceling a contract for a medical device. You're talking about personal data here, and I think you need to take a more serious look at what are going to be the sanctions written up front into your contracts when you give sensitive data for 1,100 petabytes of data across the commercial sector. This is concerning to me. With that, Mr. Chairman, I yield back.
Thank you very much. Mr. Oswald, there were recently two data breaches at the Asheville, North Carolina Medical Center. Please tell us what happened, how the medical center reacted to that, how your office responded, and how long that response took.
One of the Asheville incidents was three individuals received files containing, I think, approximately 1,500 veterans protected information. And I believe that, and it was through the My Healthy Vet portal. So it was not open email. And the three individuals, one of them self-reported back to the medical center that, hey, I think I got something that I shouldn't have gotten. And two of the messages were indicated as being read, and the third was retrieved, pulled back. The normal process of responding to that would be, as I indicated before, working with the privacy officer at the facility, the information security officer, and then the data breach response service would do the investigation and then the adjudication of how that, and I believe this indicated it was a personal protected health information, so it did warrant a notification to HHS as a protected HIPAA entity and resulting press release also. The other event
Excuse me, and how long did it take to turn that scenario around, that exercise around, to get the information collected and protected?
I would have to get back to you on the committee with that information, sir, because I don't want to speculate, but the primary emphasis is to make sure we identify the affected veterans first. So we want to make sure we get it right before we actually initiate the outreach. And there are prescribed days, a number of days in policy that we have to act, especially with a PHI HIPAA-related event.
Mr. Oswald and Ms. Griffin, let me ask you about the Clarksburg, West Virginia incident. The medical center sent 700 veterans letters with their Social Security numbers instead of their zip codes in the address line. First of all, wasn't the VA supposed to phase out using veteran Social Security numbers for purposes many years ago? And again, what was the response, and how long did that response take?
Well, to address the question about the SSN use, we do have a department-wide integrated project team now, which is identifying systems that have SSN use that need to be remediated from use. SSN use is not to be totally eliminated because there is an initial identification period, but for authentication, we will eliminate the use of that. But there's also SSN use that by law we have to share with other agencies like IRS and Social Security and things like that. So SSN use by itself will not go away, but a number of the business practices and the administrations and staff offices will change to integrate or to use what they call an integrated control number, an ICN, which is a masking identifier for veterans.
That's great moving forward. So what did we do about these 700 veterans and their Social Security numbers going out on the mail, and what was the response to that, and what kind of response time did we have?
Again, sir, I would have to go back and ask for your forbearance and put the information in the record, but the process remains the same, that there is a initial reporting by whatever entity discovers it, an investigation, and then an adjudication and a determination made is credit monitoring offered. Generally, in the cases of SSN use and a name or even the date of birth, credit monitoring offers are tendered to the veteran.
Okay, that sounds like a very timely process, and I'm thinking about someone's Social Security number and their information floating around out in the public somewhere, and that is very problematic, because I think everyone in this room certainly understands it does not take that long for someone to take that kind of information and use it in a nefarious way against our veterans. How long do you think it's going to take for you to clean up this process, which would remove the Social Security numbers from these other documents in the cases where they are not necessary?
We have identified approximately 250 applications, IT applications, that use SSN that require this type of remediation. A number of those are legacy systems that we are retiring. So rather than invest in removing the SSN for those which are going to be retired in the foreseeable future, we take a risk management approach to try and eliminate that, because in an austere fiscal environment, we can only attack so much. And there is a request in the President's FY24 budget for funds to begin this remediation effort. But the biggest part of this is, and it's not necessarily just an IT issue, it's the business practices of the administrations. I liken it to an iceberg, that there's the IT part that's above the water, but underneath the surface is a whole set of business practices from VBA, VHA.
Yeah, that's what we call bureaucracy around here. Yeah, we understand that very thoroughly.
Well, I like it.
I have run out of time, Mr. Oswald. I now recognize Ranking Member Sherifless McCormick.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. How does VA intend to structure its governance to ensure that the organization takes a strategic enterprise-wide view of the use and oversight of AI at VA?
Thank you for the question. We are still in the process of standing up the governance as per the memo that is coming out after the executive order. But at a high level, I think what we're looking to do is to maximize the impact that we can get from these systems by focusing on the agency's strategic priorities. So topics like clinician burnout and mental health, things that are consistent with the overall agency's priorities. We want to understand what are the most promising places where artificial intelligence might be applied to help with those priorities, and then obviously pursue those in a way that minimizes the risks that AI could introduce.
Mm-hmm. Mr. Worthington, you and Chief Information Officer Kurt DelBene recently hosted a press conference where you discussed the impact that Congress's failure to pass a long-term budget has on hiring VA for those with AI capabilities. If Congress continues to be unable to pass sustaining funding, what is VA's plan for working around this hurdle?
Well, we're working with what we have. You know, we are pretty tight in terms of the number of employees within OIT, and so the ability to bring new folks on with that expertise is limited. I think what we are looking to do is, as best we can, shuffle existing resources to explore these priorities. But obviously, it's hard to start new things when we're focused on running all of our existing things.
And what additional resources do you need to ensure that modernization can happen in a safe and strategic way?
I think that having experts both on the IT side as well as in the administrations that understand how to use these tools effectively is really important. The talent that we need in the government, not just at the VA, but in the government writ large that has this expertise is in extremely high demand across the country right now. And we do have a really compelling mission, though, so I think there are a number of these experts that are willing to do public service if only we can provide them, you know, a pathway into government. And so I think, first and foremost, making those opportunities available to people so that some of our country's best AI experts can easily serve is probably our top priority.
Well, I wanted to shift a little bit and talk about the academic affiliates. We have received a lot of outreach from VA's academic affiliates about a proposed new rule that would close inactive accounts after 30 days as opposed to the current 90-day rule. Can you explain how having inactive accounts poses an additional privacy risk?
This is not a topic that I am an expert on. I know at a high level what we are seeking to do is ensure that the folks that have access to VA medical data, that list is reviewed regularly and kept up to date. The specifics of how that's implemented, I would have to probably defer to some of my other colleagues and bring that back for the record if you had specific questions about that.
I saw Dr. Altowitz. Did you want to comment on that? Because I have another question, if not.
Go ahead.
The academic affiliates are concerned that given how long it takes VA to credential new users' accounts, their students will be losing a lot of educational opportunity if they rotate in and out of VA's facilities. If this proposed rule is adopted, how is VA going to ensure that students aren't left sitting around for days or weeks waiting for their user accounts to be recreated?
Again, it's a great question. I would have to defer to my colleagues and take that back for the record, but I do understand the concerns, and we obviously need to balance the security, maintaining the secure list of folks that should have access with the ease of use of getting the right people provisioned, and that's constantly a balance we're struggling to maintain.
Thank you. I yield back, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you very much, Ranking Member Surfless McCoy, Representative Self.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The breach of Lighthouse that one or more claims sharks, apparently, as we referred to them, monetized personal information. Was that process? Was that security, cybersecurity? Was it employee? How did that breach happen?
Thank you for the question. And I'm not sure that we've called that a breach, but I guess what I understand from the situation is that our Office of General Counsel assessed that some of the partners that were using the Lighthouse program were not in compliance with the Title 38 rules, and so we removed them from that program. I think that was discovered as a part of the assessment that all partners of Lighthouse should be put through a framework that we assess all public-private partnerships with. And as a part of that, the OGC group that reviews partnerships like that identified a potential issue with these.
So we're back to my sanctions. You simply remove them from the project. In the future, that will be an incentive in your for your partners to monetize, to use the information improperly. They'll use it improperly, they'll get the benefit from it, and you'll simply remove them from the program. In my mind, that's not a significant enough sanction. And you have Dr. Altarevich, you have a very high-sounding name, the National AI Institute. So is this the National AI Institute with overall jurisdiction for AI development in the nation? Are there other national institutes for AI?
We're the one within the VA. We were started as a joint effort between the Office of Research and Development and the Secretary's Center for Strategic Partnerships.
Are there other national institutes in the United States?
Oh, there are definitely other national institutes on a number. I mean, like
So which department has overall jurisdiction for the development of AI?
There's no one, to my knowledge, there's no one department that has that is associated with developing all of AI. A number of agencies, the Department of Energy, HHS, they have either centers of excellences or institutes for
and
AI.
That brings me to my last point, Mr. Chairman. We've heard, we've dealt with the EOs here, the executive orders. I haven't heard a lot about law. One of the issues that this Congress is starting to deal with is clawing back Article I authority in light of the overreach of Article II authorities through EOs, through executive orders. Mr. Chairman, I recommend we get into that. Why are we focused on EOs, executive orders? Why are we using them as the baseline here? What is the law that is going to operate not only with this national institute, but the national institutes across the United States? So I think we've got a bigger issue here that we perhaps this committee could delve into and lead the way toward. What is the law on AI development? Thank you. I'll yield back.
Thank you very much, Representative Self, and that is a truly good concept, and you're right, we have been working towards that to regain the power for Congress, for all of us. Mr. Alterowitz, another of your priority AI uses cases is applying machine learning to patients' genetic and phenotypic information to predict and optimize surgery outcomes. That's how their genes affect the response to medication and their observable physical traits. What ethical challenges do you think that could pose? For example, if AI says don't do the surgery based on a veteran's genes, what's the surgeon's responsibility? And again, is that patient advised of who generated this prognosis, man or machine?
Right. Yeah, thank you for your question. I think there are a number of use cases that we're evaluating at different stages, and that's one of the key things that we're looking at, trustworthy AI at the beginning. And there's a number of principles there, and a number of the areas you mentioned are ones that we would look at. A few that come to mind, you know, as you said, the genetics, you can have different demographics. You may have to look at different single nucleotide polymorphisms, basically different parts of the genetics may be applicable. How do you quantify their surgical outcomes in different settings, rural, non-rural? I mean, there are a lot of questions like that. And so when they are research projects, there's more time to engage and to do that. And then in other projects, if we don't find it consistent, there's time to make a consistency plan where we kind of keep going back and getting more questions answered, maybe analyzing some of that data.
Mr. Alterowitz,
yes.
I understand that additional information is good. We have all of that data coming in. But again, the first thing that I go back to is, shouldn't this be disclosed to the veterans? Shouldn't this be disclosed to the patients that they understand exactly who is performing this analysis and creating this prognosis?
Right. Well, for research studies, we do have informed consent through, IRBs. Through non-research, we've developed and are piloting something called a model card, which basically is like a pamphlet that explains how the AI is being used for different settings. So one setting may be for the patient. Another setting may be for the doctor who is interested in other parts of how the AI works. So model cards are a way that we are now pioneering. And we're not the only ones pioneering this, but we're really looking at it in the healthcare setting and piloting to see how that works across the network.
Okay, Mr. Alterowitz, here's another example. You're using natural language processing to extract signals of suicide risk from clinical progress notes and other medical records. We need to do whatever we can to prevent veteran suicide. We know that I've heard everything from 19 veterans a day to as high as 24. But we need to be extremely careful. First of all, how prone to false positives is the software, and what level of accuracy do you consider acceptable? I'm concerned that this could lead to a violation of veterans' rights, limiting personal freedoms, and gun ownership.
Yeah, thank you for your question. I think everything that you've said are concerns that need to be looked at. So where this uses AI is in the natural language processing, right? Looking at those notes and extracting potential meaning out of it. There's always a human in the loop that then looks at the results. And so this is a way to help them shift through a large amount of text. And
there's a human reviewing that, but there's also a human who's creating those notes.
Correct.
So we have a very subjective a component that is part of this analysis that we have to be very, very careful of. So do the veterans know that the VA is using this technology? And if so, could it color, could it taint what they're willing to tell their healthcare providers?
For ones that are involved in research, there's a consent form and then they would be aware. For ones in operations, generally there are tools used that have been publicized on our website through the inventory that explain how they use AI.
Okay, so we still don't have a good, consistent disclosure process that is being utilized and being signed off by our veterans, correct? Across the system.
That is correct. I do not.
Okay. Again, please, that has got to be elevated to a top priority. It absolutely has to be elevated to a top priority. I would yield to. Oh, I have no more. Okay. Goodness gracious. Okay. Where do I go? I want to thank our witnesses for joining us this afternoon. It's been an enlightening discussion. It truly has. Excuse me. I'm sorry. When you said you didn't have any more. Go ahead. I will yield to Representative Sherfless McCormick for a closing statement then.
Thank you. Thank you again to the witnesses for being here today. It is absolutely crucial that we do everything in our power to ensure that the data veterans have entrusted VA with is protected, and that we ensure that no one, VA and its vendors alike, is monetizing that data for personal gain. I'm also grateful for today's conversation about the use of artificial intelligence at VA. The opportunity that AI provides to improve patient care and access, as well as reducing the administrative burden of VA personnel, are exciting. However, as the proverb goes, with great power comes great responsibility. We've already seen how AI can be used for less noble purposes. AI deepfakes have been all over the news recently. These uses of the technology are unacceptable. I'm convinced that this is just the beginning of our oversight of AI and how it can safely be applied at the VA. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, for this great discussion, and I yield back.
Thank you very much, Representative Sherfless McCormick. Again, I'd like to thank everyone for joining us this afternoon. It has been lightning discussion. I think that we all have identified some areas that right now, immediately, we're going to be able to go out and take some action items for Congress to do their part and for the Veterans Administration to do their part to make sure that the veterans are, again, getting the best care that they possibly can. This is by no means the last hearing that the committee will hold on artificial intelligence. It's an expanding, complex area that warrants serious oversight. I want to thank Dr. Miller Meeks and the Health Subcommittee for working with us and for delving into AI projects that the Veterans Health Administration has underway. With that, I ask unanimous consent that all members have 5 legislative days to revise and extend their remarks and include extraneous material. And without objection, we will adjourn.